This is, by the way, that you recall that Ayatollah Khomeini communicated with his revolutionaries in Iran in the days of the revolution, but by tape. He didn't wait to go through the slow process of printing and publication, which may be very difficult or absolutely impossible in those days because of the clampdown, of course. But he managed to smuggle tapes right into Iran through his couriers, and they were played for clandestine groups of revolutionaries there and in the mosques and so on, and by pirate radio stations right up until they overthrew the Shah. Well, we will continue to communicate, God willing, in that fashion. And I believe we will be able to, because I'm sure God is going to use us to the very end till Jesus comes. There wouldn't be any point leaving us here if he didn't. So, which means there will still be work for us to do, family to feed and lead, and souls to be won, and witnessing to be done, praise God, even if you don't win them. The witnessing has to be done in order to hold them accountable and responsible for their actions, their deeds, and either their reception or rejection when the final judgment comes. So, this is sort of telling you what the conditions are now and what I expect to happen after the war. That should be encouraging and a good positive note, perhaps, to start this last lesson on, and we're about halfway through already. And that is that we will be able to continue and minister after the war. Praise God. I believe it. Don't you? Amen? Now, as you can see, as a matter of logistics, since at least two-thirds of the family that remain, not two-thirds of the present family, I'm hoping that two-thirds of the family, the three-fourths of our total present family, will still be alive after the war. But at the slow rate you're leaving the North, nuclear North, it doesn't look like you're going to make it, because I expect the war so soon now that you're just not all going to make it. Some of you didn't want to, some of you didn't care to, some of you couldn't, and some of you didn't dare to, and some of you simply dragged your feet too long, and you'll get caught like Lot's wife in the destructive outpouring that comes. But with approximately, after the war now I'm talking about, of the remaining family, see, we have about 2,500 homes now, and we hope approximately half of that, 1,200 in Latin America by that time, and maybe another 600 or 700 or so in the rest of the world gone south. We hope we'll have at least two-thirds to three-fourths of the family left. But of those two-thirds to three-fourths, about two-thirds of them will be in Latin America. And about a third of you will be in Southeast Asia in the islands of the sea, or South Africa. Well, now, as you can see, under restricted travel and restricted borders and so on, they clamped down both during wars and after wars until things begin to be restored to what they used to call, after both world wars, normalization and rehabilitation and so on. It would be harder to travel from country to country, but even more difficult to travel or communicate from one continent across the sea to another continent, across another big sea to Southeast Asian continent and the islands of the sea, Australia and New Zealand and so on. So that there will be considerable difficulty in communication, long-distance transoceanic communication, by the telephone, which will be probably controlled and tapped and maybe only used for government purposes, such as in the present trouble in Poland. Government can immediately clamp down on communication so that only government communication is allowed. So in the aftermath of the war, because of the tremendous problems of recovery, there may be no communication between continents for a while, and little, if any, travel. So we may not be able to courier communications across these oceans to other continents, much less halfway around the world from Latin America clear around to Southeast Asia and the East Indies and Australia and so on. So you leaders in this remote, smaller part of the family, now let's remember, you'll only be about approximately one-third, hopefully, if enough of you move south to this area after the war. But you may be only one-fourth of the family. So naturally, priority has to be given to the two-thirds or three-fourths who will still be here in South America, Latin America. Whereas if only about one-third or even possibly only one-fourth of the remaining family, surviving family, are in Southeast Asia, in the islands of the seas, and Australia and so on, it'll be very difficult for any publishing unit over here in South America to communicate with you folks clear halfway around the world in Southeast Asia and the Pacific and so on, India, Australia. So, except for some rare miracles of God, and I'm hoping and expecting for some rare miracles, you may only get an occasional visitor from the Western Hemisphere who may come praising God and bearing gifts and tapes and maybe a little lit or messages or letters from us to this part of the world. Naturally, our publishing unit will have to most likely be located here in South America or Latin America in order to ensure our reaching most of the family, most of whom will be here after the war, God willing, and ministering to most of them here. Naturally, the publishing unit, where I'll be, I don't know. Our publishing unit, who will be in charge of the duplication, multiplication, and distribution of the word, will no doubt be located somewhere in South America. And we're working on that now. But it will be difficult to communicate over here, and you folks who are in this far remote area had better hang on to your magazines, letters, books, tapes, and so on, because that may be the only food you'll have for a while. Leaders may find it difficult to travel, but I'm expecting good leaders like Keita and Ho and some of the rest of you there to be able to come to the fore at that time, and if I'm not over there myself, you take over and furnish the leadership and the faith that will be necessary, and you NASAs and GASAs and top leaders who have already been chosen by that time, we hope, will be able to keep the family in communication and keep them in touch and in tune and in fellowship and in the news. Get our news. I hope they're not too much in the news unless it's good news. And be able to continue to feed them and care for them, care for the flock, and to lead them and guide them and furnish them with the word as much as you can from us or what you've already got. After all, by the time the war hits, you've had enough word from us already, which would be able to guide you for the rest of the end time, that you wouldn't even have to hear from us again, necessarily. I have told you enough. I've explained enough about what is happening and going to happen. You should have enough knowledge and wisdom so that, as the Lord says, that they which are strong and know their God shall do exploits, and they shall instruct many. You will already know, and you will already be strong, and you already know God, and you can get your orders directly from Him. You don't have to hear from me anymore. If you're cut off from me, ask God, and ask the Lord, and ask your leaders there. Work together. These are our contingency plans for after the war. You will have to be much on your own, and God's going to have to raise up prophets among you to get orders directly from the Lord. You're going to have to individually ask God what to do, get your orders straight from the Lord and from your leaders there, and continue on the best you can according to God's word and what we've told you before and what you know is His will already, and keep going into all the world and preaching the gospel to every creature that you can, right up to the very bitter end of the Antichrist reign and the joyful end of your stay on earth in the resurrection, the rapture, in the coming of Jesus Christ. Hallelujah. Amen. Praise God. Well, I might have a minute or so to tell you what I think, why, and this may help scare you out of that nuclear north, and that is that the U.S. is saying it will not be ready to fight Russia for about 2 or 3 years to be equal to really do the job right. Well, if you were a Russian, would you say, well, I'm going to wait till the U.S. is ready to fight us and really ready to wipe us out, and then we'll attack? Is that what you do? No. You, if you had common sense, you'd say, well, as soon as we get a good excuse to give the rest of the world and the third world and our partners in crime or in world salvation, whatever the U.S., when we see she's threatening the world too much, we will say, well, it's time for us to press the button and have the first strike attack so we can wipe out that dangerous North America, especially the United States, so they won't destroy so much of the world. And at least whatever they've got left to retaliate with will not do so much destruction. And so the best thing to do is, just as quick as we are able, is a first preemptive strike to knock the U.S. out, and so there will not be much war left and not much nuclear retaliation left. That would be the safest thing, frankly, not for the U.S., but for the rest of the world. And I'm sure that that's probably what they're going to do. So I expect it almost any minute, except for us and the Lord helping us, you get out of that nuclear north and our important units and leadership to get out of the north. So as soon as we do, and you hear they are, you'd better watch out, because I wouldn't be surprised then God's going to let them press the button and wipe out the U.S., North America, and much of Europe, and you'll be gone if you're not gone already. So you'd better get out and get out now if you expect to survive and do God any good, and do the rest of the world any good, and do the family any good, and continue to witness and win souls, and do anything at all for the Lord, as well as merely selfishly survive your own stinking self, which is not important at all unless you're going to do somebody else some good. If you're going to do the rest of the world any good, if you're going to do the family any good, if you're going to still witness and win souls, you're going to have to survive and be out of the North by the time the war hits. Contrary to the natural expectation of some military theorists, as I told you last time, the war is not going to begin gradually with a conventional attack in Europe, as so many of these stupid militarists are predicting and hoping, and gradually escalate to tactical nuclear warfare here in Europe, and then finally to intercontinental warfare. No, that's not the way it's going to happen. God didn't say that. God said that it's going to happen so sudden that it'll cause a great, mighty widening of the eyes. Such great confusion will happen so suddenly that it'll cause a mighty widening of the eyes, a great surprise. Most of the people, only you and I, the few of us, know how it's going to happen and where it's going to happen and when it's going to happen, which is a lot sooner than they expect. Not 2 or 3 years from now when they're ready, but now, soon, within the next few months, I expect it. And if I'm wrong, I'm sorry. But I'd rather tell you that now and be wrong later and leave you in the north than to find out you were wrong and I was right. And you're no longer in the north. You're gone completely. You're wiped out. According to what God has told us, the war is going to begin very suddenly, with great surprise, a great widening of the eyes, a sudden holocaustic destruction when somebody makes a preemptive strike, and I think it's going to be Russia, in order to try to save the world. What do you think God wants to do? Do you think God wants an all-out nuclear war between both powers, with both powers having enough warning to gradually escalate to all-out nuclear war and destroy that much more of the earth? Which would be the best thing for him to allow the world to do? For one power or the other to make a preemptive strike, knock the other power out completely so there will be very little retaliation and half as much nuclear holocaust. Of course, that's the best thing to do. And, of course, the easiest power to knock out is the United States. And the one that deserves it the most is the United States, because they've had the most gospel and become the most hardened, have been the most rebellious and rejective, just like Israel was when God decided to sock it to her and wipe her out and leave just a very few remnant left because of her rebelliousness and stubbornness and disobedience and refusal to obey God, refusal to kowtow to the world power that day
To survive a little longer and be witnesses for him, they flatly refused to heed the message of Jeremiah. They stuck to their guns, so to speak, there in the city of Jerusalem, instead of surrendering to Babylon of the day and managing to survive, most of them, longer. They insisted on staying there, defending their homes and their city until they were wiped out. One-third by the sword, one-third by famine and by fire, and one-third went into slavery. Now, Jeremiah gave them a message that if they would yield to the king of Babylon, who is similar to the coming king of Antichrist and the Antichrist government, the communism and so on, that at least, he said, your lives will be for a trophy or to spare. Your lives will be saved, and you'll at least be able to save your lives, but be under subjection and subservience to the king of Babylon. He probably would have made them then a client state, a taxed and duty-paying state, and he probably would have just made them a conquered nation, and they could have continued to run their own affairs more or less as long as they bowed down to Babylon, and as long as they continued to serve Babylon and pay their tariffs and taxes and duties and the levies that he would levy on them in the way of taxes and whatever he required of his conquered nation, Israel. But instead of that, they refused. They got stubborn, sassy, talked back, said, we refuse. We're not going to pay taxes anymore to you. So he just marched in with his armies and wiped them out, mopped them up. Totally destroyed their country, their city, and killed most of them, two-thirds of them, and took the others as prisoners, slaves, back to Babylon, and just left the poor hiding out in the brush and the boonies and the bush and the woods out in the countryside, along with releasing dear prophet Jeremiah from jail. God let Jeremiah be put in jail for his own safety so that during the war he wouldn't get hurt. And so that after the war, when the Babylonians were in complete control, they came along and released him. Even gave him money because they thought he'd been on their side simply because he prophesied the doom of Israel and their victory. They thought he was really one of their friends, that he was a fifth columnist and a sympathizer, and that he was a good guy, and he had said the right things, and so they thought he was a great fellow. Good for you, boy. You were preaching for the right side, that we were going to win, and so here you are. Here's your freedom. Here's whatever you need, some money, and go ahead with whatever people you got left, and you can remain right here and do as you please. Take over whatever is left, which wasn't much. Well, if I was a prophet of God and I was still in the U.S., maybe God would spare me that way. And that's probably the only way I would have been spared, in jail, and that's probably where I would be. But I don't look forward to you to seeing two-thirds of the U.S. population totally wiped out and only one-third surviving on almost nothing and the horror of the chaos that's going to be left. So I got out. I followed Jeremiah's advice, his advice a long time ago. And we got out, and most of our family has gotten out, thank God. There's only about one of our 2,500 homes, only about 400 left in the U.S., which means that's only about, one-sixth of our family who are still in the United States. Is that right? 400 is about one-sixth of 2,500, 2,400, whatever it is. We go up and down depending on how you're moving around. Right now we're a little down because a lot of you have left and you're not actually reporting a home. Our reports aren't in yet. The reports from Latin America are beginning to boom. We're getting so many families down there, we can hardly take care of them all. So I'm expecting to hear you show up and the records show up on our computers that you're down south the next time we hear from you, although you've disappeared temporarily and failed to get in your report or thought you didn't have to while you were moving. You didn't have to tithe, but I got a pretty hot letter to you about that in this last magazine.
that that's no excuse for letting down your tithing as long as your income is not let down. There's no excuse ever for letting down your tithing just because you're moving. So you think because, well, I'm obeying, I'm moving, so I don't have to tithe my full tithe. Uh-uh, that's not obeying. You've still got to tithe, beloved. You've still got to give God his due. He's only asking 10%. Only one out of $10 or whatever it is. That's not much if you're not a full-time servant. Oh, but I'm 100%, 10%, or I'm a full-time servant. I'm giving my whole life to the Lord. I give everything to the Lord, really. So why should I have to tithe at all? Well, I'll tell you one reason you have to tithe. First of all, because God's word says so. Next of all, because God, I've told you so. And last of all, because if you don't, you're not going to get the magazine or the books or tapes nor nothing. So that ought to be a pretty good reason. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. God has ways. I've got one big stick that I can wield, and that's the word. And if you are naughty, I'll wield it and spank you with it. But watch out when God quits talking and quits spanking, and you are excommunicated, and you no longer even hear from the Lord like poor old Saul. That's bad business. And you'll be out of touch, out of communication, out of fellowship. You won't know what's going on. Alienated from the life of God, darkening your understanding, alienated from the life of God and past feelings, he told me. I hope that never happens to you. Praise the Lord. Well, now this is what I expect, and this is the way I expect things to go. And what I expect to happen now, what's happening now. And so my last point is on how soon the war, I think God's going to let it unleash just as quick as most of us, as many as he thinks are necessary to be out of the North, and important leadership and world service units to carry on into the safer South. As soon as he thinks enough of us are there to be able to carry on what he wants to do there, then he's going to let it rip, even if you haven't left the North. I'm sorry, but he just can't wait forever. That the world would go too far and too long, and there would be worse Holocaust, worse disaster, more catastrophe, more destruction the longer he waits. It's just as simple as can be. Even a little child can understand it. I'll bet you, Tetchy, you could understand it. That the longer he waits, the more missiles they're making, and the more missiles they'll use, the more atom bombs they'll drop, and the more of the earth's surface that he created to be inhabited, enjoyed by man, and the more people that he made will be destroyed. And he doesn't want that to happen. He's going to try to save the world. And right now, before his own kingdom on earth, about the only way he's going to be able to save the world and its surface and its population is to destroy the power which is the greatest threat to the safety of the world today, and that is the United States of America. Because if he can knock the U.S. out first and quick before they get their missiles off the ground, or as few as possible, well, and the more thorough job the Russians do on it, then the fewer missiles will be fired and the fewer lives will be lost, and the less the destruction and the Holocaust, the less the cost. So if you were God, what would you do? If you saw that Russia had greater power already, and a tough, tyrannical, hard, tough government is what a wicked world needs, and the only kind of government that can control a wicked, anti-God, anti-Bible, anti-Christ world, this is the kind of government God gives such a people. You look at the history of the world. The more godless people became, the more wicked they became, then the tougher kings he gave them, and the tougher empires he gave them, the greater, more powerful, widespread empires to control the world, to try to keep down the wars and keep down the destruction and to keep down the horrible loss of life and to keep people in line from destroying the earth and destroying themselves, he created a bigger, more powerful, tougher government every time, with tougher kings, tougher dictators, harder, sterner, more tyrannical governments
to try to keep the people in line. Until you have to practically keep the wicked people almost in a government that's like a prison, a police state. It's of God. When people get that wicked, that's what they deserve, is jail. Or a country that's a jail, a police state. And this time, the coming world government, because the world is so worldwide wicked, and even communism more righteous than capitalism, he's going to have a government which is a worldwide prison, and a worldwide dictator, and a worldwide, one world, tough, tyrannical, dictatorial government by man. And believe it or not, it is going to be the best government man ever had. It's going to try to be. It's going to be the best organized, the best economically, with a credit economic system. It's going to be the best best organized, strictest, most law-abiding, toughest, worldwide police state the world's ever had. It's going to really keep things in line. Not even the Russians allow the kind of rot that goes on in the United States. Not even the communists can stomach the kind of vice and corruption and greedy, selfish finances that goes on in the United States and in world capitalism. So in the sight of God, even the communists are more righteous than in their relationships with man with man, and in their morality, their morals, and in their conduct, and will be in their government more so than what the capitalist world is today. So which system do you think God is most apt to spare, and which do you think he's most apt to destroy? Well, he's going to destroy the most corrupt and wicked and greedy and selfish and rotten and hardest gospel-hardened system that has had more than its chance, and that's the United States of America. And he's going to spare, believe it or not, the communists a little longer, give them a little more time, about 7 more years after the war, with the rise, or maybe a little more, with the rise of the Antichrist and a world dictator and a world government to clamp down on the world and hold it in a vice-like grip that will make it behave itself and make it obey the law and make it conduct itself a little more decently and make it share its wealth with the poor. That's what it's going to be. An iron government like ancient Rome. Ancient Rome even had more democracy in some ways, but a stronger government, not more democracy, but more freedom in some ways. Under a strong world government, there was freer travel for Roman citizens from country to country. It was all better in many ways under the iron grip of Rome. Although it was a tough military government, things were better. So things are going to be better for a little while. But it's going to be under a communist world government, I'm convinced. And the Antichrist will rise out of communism. If it's not called communism, it'll still be the beginnings of it. It's the red beast, the red dragon, and every indication that that's what it is, God's word says. The great power of the north is going to do it. So it is in the goodness and the mercy and the justice of God that God will allow communism to triumph and the Antichrist to become the world government, to give the world its last chance and its last knowledge of Christ as well and the gospel as we preach it, its last witness. But as it becomes more and more Antichrist and more against God and the gospel, of course, it'll become more and more guilty, even though more righteous in some respects economically and in government and so on, it'll become more and more guilty spiritually. And when the devil himself in the form of the Antichrist sets up his kingdom, and he tries to make everybody worship him and blot out and kill everybody else that doesn't, then God's going to have to stop his government and step in and intervene, and God is going to have to bring an end to that kind of government. But actually, beloved, the Antichrist world empire is going to be man's last chance in this era, in this stage, in this age.
his last chance to be saved as we are.